Welcome to our Timoney Leaders Series. My name is Ronan O'Farrell. I'm CEO of the Timoney Leadership Institute, and you're very welcome to our interview with Brian McConville. From Rathfrieland in Uri in Northern Ireland, Brian is the founder, owner and chairman of the MJM Group, which includes MJM Marine, one of the world's leading marine outfitting businesses, which he started himself back in 1983. And the group also includes MyVan, a leading specialist joinery business, and Top Glass, a specialist glass supplier as well. Back in 2018, MJM Group fitted out the Asmara Pursuit for the Royal Caribbean at Harland & Wolff, the largest project of its kind in Belfast for decades, which was great to see it happening in Belfast and the docks again. And Brian was also awarded CBE on this New Year's honours list back in at the beginning of the year for services to the economy and to charity in Northern Ireland. A very well deserved honour by Queen Elizabeth. And last but not least, Brian is also one of our alumni in the Timoney Leadership Institute, having done our advanced leadership programme a couple of years ago. So, Brian, I'm delighted to welcome you, and thank you for joining us on the Leader Series.
Good evening, Ronan, and thanks very much for having me, and I hope I don't bore you too much. I have a hard job ahead of you trying to keep me in line, but there you go.
We're looking forward to it. Well, before we get stuck in, just to say to those listening, if you'd like to ask Brian a question, if you're listening live, to use the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen, and if we can, we will get to those in the course of the discussion. So, Brian, maybe if I can start, where did this entrepreneurial bug, entrepreneurial drive that you have to get started in business, where did that come from? I know you began with pony rides on the beach.
You know, Ronan, over my life, when I was in my 30s, if you'd asked me the question, I might not know how to answer it in the 40. If I thought of an idea, I'd answer it. And as I matured through my life, I had all these ideas of what an entrepreneur is and how is one born or formed or whatever the case is. But I look back on my life, and now that I'm fast approaching 60, I'm looking back at my life and I'm saying, you know, all the little things that happened, you know, just the tiny little things like, there was a time, I don't actually know when the year was, but it could have been, I would have been pretty young. So it could have been in the late 60s or the very early 70s in the farming, because as I think most people know, I was born and reared on a farm. I remember once going to say that I can get a calf for a pound and bringing it home, and I reared it on a goat and I sold it for 90 pounds. And that was one little thing. And I'd forgot about that for years, but the fact that I'd done that, and I pushed my father and all of the things to go to make that happen. And then, you know, persuading my family to allow me to take my pony to the beach and walk up and down the beach and have pockets of money and loose change. And, you know, all of those things that I think these things are developed. You know, there's not a light bulb, not a light bulb moment in my life that I could turn around and say, these things happened. But anyway, there you go. There are some of my very, very early years of some of the very, very first things. So I was probably 9, 10, 12. I'd stopped giving pony rides by the time I was 12 or 13. So I'd done that for 3 or 4 years.
But you always had a couple of jobs on the go as you were growing through your teens.
So when you're born on a farm, sure, it was up early in the morning, you had work to do. Before you went to, you had your chores to do on the farm before you went to school. Mm. You rushed into the house, your mother got you washed and cleaned for school and away to primary school or secondary school, whatever the case was, with your school bag over your shoulder. And it was as fast as you could get home in the evening because there's loads of chores to do around the farm.
Yeah.
Whatever those chores were, you done those, and you maybe got a while to yourself to ride your pony or whatever. But when I come of age, I think about 14, I decided that I was smart enough, I have to say. I didn't need much more schooling. Just didn't agree. It was one of those things. I was working I was holding down three or four jobs at that time, and I was working on a local building site. I was working with local farmers. I was working in a local hotel. So schooling wasn't really my big topic. A few years later, whenever I started to realize what I'd done wrong, I think I could have enjoyed a bit of school work. But there you go, such is life.
Well, you came back on it right throughout the rest of your career. We can talk about that. Well, for anyone who isn't familiar, can you give us a top line overview of what you then went on to found eventually MJM,
quickly as I can. Left school, went and got myself a trade as a joiner. Moved down to Dublin. Was in Dublin for a few years. Then fell in with a very, very professional company. Spent 6 or 7 years with them. Ending up in the Middle East. Come home out of the Middle East. Started to do work for this company in Northern Ireland. Then the recession hit, and I went over to England looking for some work. And there, it was there that I discovered, going across in the ferry, that I'd seen the guys. And I said to the barman, who does all this type of work inside the ships? Give me a name in Dublin. And I was quite taken by, I don't know, the glitzy paints or whatever. Ships are still quite glitzy. And I think it's the mixture of all the different products from fabrics to stainless steels and so on and so forth. So I got the bug for sort of fitting out ships, starting off with local ferries and then going into cruise ships. It's quite a journey over 25 odd years from then to now. There's lots to be talked about and thought about in that journey. But on the high level end of it, I ended up creating a company called MJM Marine Limited, who we over 15 years come to be from going into the American market, coming into the American market, being nobody, to being having to say, not my words, but our customers' words and our competitors' words, probably the best outfitting company in the world.
Best in the, fantastic, isn't it? Hear that from a customer or customers.
Yeah, it's you know, there's certain little telltale signs that you get along the way that you hear, and it's a big achievement. You know, Roland, I was only driving the bus, you know. It's all them other guys in the bus that made this happen, you know. I was on the journey. It's you know, let's not for one moment think that this was a single-handed, that this was Macondo charging up the hill on his own, you know. It wasn't going to happen that way.
Yeah.
There was a huge, huge team of people behind me, very loyal people behind me, that actually at a very young age all found and adopted my vision, and we all worked for the one thing. Sorry for rambling, but there you go.
And I heard you say somewhere, like some of those people you started out with are still with you, or were until...
Funny, I was in MJM yesterday, and we had a board meeting yesterday morning, a strategic meeting yesterday afternoon, and I was walking around, and there's one particular guy just comes to, he was the very, very first employee that I employed 38 years ago. And him and I had a chat yesterday and went into another office, and there's three or four of my senior guys have been with me 30 plus years. And, you know, which I always like to add in, because it's very, very important for people that are listening and for people to understand this, especially the modern mums and dads. Three or four of those guys all started off life with apprenticeships and went from apprentice joiners to whatever they went on. And now they're senior executive sitting on a fairly decent board of a company. So it's not to be sneezed at.
Yeah, if they get the right start with what fits for them, it can go.
But generally, what we're really saying to people is, you know, we're saying to the younger generation, if you've got a vision, you know, it doesn't matter. You don't have to be a chemist. You don't have to be a doctor. You don't have the brains to run. But if you've got ambition and you're a hard worker and you've got a skill or whatever it is, you know, you can come through.
Yeah.
University is not the end of the world. I shouldn't be saying that, and you, but you know,
it's a leadership
institution, but you know, it's a big fact.
Yeah, no, it makes a lot of sense to get the right fit for what suits people, and we're great believers in that, and knowing yourself and knowing what your strengths are and where your preferences lie, and and make it flourish.
Absolutely.
And the choices you make. Well, just briefly on the name, MJM, now international recognition in the cruise line industry, but can you tell us where the name came from?
I have to make it funny because you would cry otherwise, you know, it's one of those things, you know. I went to an accountant, and funny, I would meet him once or twice a year. He must be in his 80s now, but I said to him, look, I need to set up a company. And he says, that's okay. So can you do that? I asked him, he says, yes, I can do that. I can all the registrations and so on and so forth. And I said, that's great. And I was just leaving. He's just leaving his office. It was quite a short meeting, half an hour. And he says, well, I need a name. And I says, but I told you my name. My name's Brian McCombe. But he says, no, I need a name for the company. And I says, okay. And he says, something like X, Y, and Z. I says, okay. I says, well, I work for a company called JMJ. So let's call it the opposite of JMJ. And we went for MJM. So then for the next 20 years, you know, the company was called MJM, and everybody had all sorts of ideas what it was, and I had to come up with some sort of a slogan for it. So the slogan we had for it was McConville's Jolly Men, MJM.
Fantastic.
So that was the slogan we had, but that's the reality of it, and I try to make it as funny as I can because there's no thought process.
But it just shows you can create a fantastic brand if you have behind it.
We have spent thousands and thousands and thousands of cents on the MJM, and all sorts of different managers come in and different people come into our businesses and what color it should be and how it should look. And you know, we spent thousands and thousands. And you know what? At the end of the day, we just keep, you know, we've never done anything with it. Yeah, we've glossed it up a little bit, but it's still MJM. So there you go.
Very good. Well, I mean, you mentioned it there, like a lot of hard work has gone in behind. What other ingredients do you think we're in the mix to make MGM so successful? I mean, you mentioned the team as well, being a team on the bus, but what other ingredients would you identify looking back now might be helpful for others in your following footsteps?
You know, I hear people talking about passion all the time, and sometimes I look a little bit strange and I try to sort of look into them or to find out exactly what do they mean by having a passion, but it's quite true. It's quite true. I, as a young person, had a passion for quality.
Mm.
Hanging the door in the house and sticking on a roof was, I'm not saying everybody can do it, but you know, there was a standard that was a standard, and the standard was never good enough. And I wanted something more. And when I go places, you touch the vernage and say, "Oh, that's lovely." And I had the ambition to manufacture that furniture and do things. So there's a passion there for quality. That was the core. And then what happened was then when we go to people and we go to different customers and they say, well, can you do that? And he says, of course we can do that. We can do anything, you know. Not necessarily really understanding or knowing how I was going to do it, but I always would say, yeah, we can do that. And then I'd worry about how I was going to do it later. But there's quite a few stories and quite a few examples around that. But out of that, we created a can-do attitude. So, you know, whether the guy was only one of the guys, you know, we were all just working. It just happened to be that I paid them the end of the week and I was the one that could give off to them and they're standing around. But, we generally worked as a team, and it ended up, we had this really strong can-do attitude. And I use the word we. You'll hear me talking about we all the time. Mm-hmm. So we had this very, very strong can-do attitude, must deliver the product. You know, McCombs told the boss he's going to get it next Wednesday. So if we have to work Saturday evening or a couple of late nights to get it to the boss next Wednesday, the boss would get it next Wednesday. And the boss was always who was paying us, our customers. So, you know, a little bit of vision, a little bit of passion. We had a passion for quality. Mm-hmm. We never really liked to let people down, and we always said we could do something, we wanted to do it and get it done.
And in all of that, when you say not let people down and the quality being really important, what about the sort of, you know, not being afraid to make mistakes, possibility of failure? How much did that play in the mix as well, of you really wanting to make
you know,
sure.
When you're young and you're young and you're innocent and you don't have too much to lose, so where's the risk? You know, you just put on, you know, and this is true. You know, I've had this conversation with many a person, and you know, when I was in my 20s coming up through with the business and the 30s, you know, work was work. We just got up and we done our very, very best. We pleased our customer the best we could. We moved on to the next job. We never really wanted to fail anybody. There was people coming along and said, well, can you do this? And we always said we could. And in most cases, we didn't know how to do it, but we'd find people that didn't know how to do it. So we just learned to adapt with, you know, we got this attitude that we could do nothing. There's nothing that we couldn't do. Was there a risk in it? Well, what was the risk in it? We just didn't get it exactly as the person wanted it, but we got it close.
Yeah.
You know, and our interpretation and their interpretation, well, then that would lead you to have a conversation. So risk and so on and so forth. But that then comes to be a very, very serious, serious criteria when you get traction within your business. And I'm not saying we've got traction now, but many, many years ago, we started to get traction.
Yeah.
Then this word risk came into me. But at that stage, I had already set the seeds with a team of people that knew exactly how to manufacture the product, how to find all the materials, how to please the company and please our customers. And then I had there's one of the things that we could talk about, but I then had to sort of step out of that role where I was as the leader of that team, appoint a couple of the other guys to do that work for me. And then I went in then to a more strategic role within the business. And then to find out was, then I learned about financing. Then I learned about risk. Then I learned about management and health. And, well, we always were health and safety, but you learn more about how critical health and safety was and how critical the environment was and all of these things. It was like me starting a whole new business again when I moved from the operational side into the management side.
Management. And how, I mean, that's a transition that a lot of founders and owners find really quite challenging, because you know, you had your sleeves rolled up and you were in the middle of it all making it happen. How did you find that? Was it an easy transition for you?
No.
Yeah.
It was very, very difficult.
Any advice for somebody following in your footsteps now as to how they would do that more in a better way?
Yeah. You have to own it. You know, it's difficult. Mm-hmm. It's difficult. You know, you have to sit down and, you know, I'm not great at telling you what to do, how to do it. But I'm good at telling you examples that happened to me.
Yeah.
A guy who we were employing at the time, much more of his experience. Our turnover was starting to grow. We were looking and shaping like a real business. You know, we want this sort of two-bit store that opened up on the father's farm and then slowly grew up a business. We probably were employing 30 or 40 people. So we were starting to make something real. All of a sudden, I went out for a manager and brought on this new manager. And the manager came in and he said, you're doing this wrong, doing that wrong. And he told us and he worked with us, and I would listen to him and I would tentatively question him, and I would bore him, and I would exhaust him out with the questions I would ask him, and then I would try to figure out which was the most important, and I'd bring them back to my team. And all of the time I was learning. And, you know, I think it's probably one of the biggest things that happened to me. You know, he said to me one day, he took me over to the window, and it's everybody has different ways of doing things. So he took me over to the window and he looked out and he says, what's that? And I looked down and he says, all I can see is my car. He says, yeah. He says, there's a nice Mercedes, blah, blah. I said, yeah, yeah. What's that? The vice guy. He says, what more do you want in life? And we weren't doing too bad at this stage. So what happened was, you okay there? Can you still see me?
Yeah? No, that's fine. You're back. Yeah.
I don't know what happened there, but actually, him by saying I had arrived and I had enough and a nice Mercedes and I didn't need, was the sauce that I needed to turn around and say to myself, do you know what? I can do much, much more than this. Mm-hmm. I'm fit. I'm only coaching here. I'm only just breezing along. I can put myself to quite a bit more pressure or quite a bit more stress it's probably a bit of a kick in that I needed just to get me winded up to move on to the next level. And I was that busy sort of in the middle of it saying, I'll show everybody that I can go more and better. That the transition on to having to go to meet the bankers and having to meet the accountants and the solicitors and going out to meet the customers and arguing with suppliers and subcontractors not delivering stuff on time and so on and so forth, and taking on all of the, and I would nearly say whether, I would nearly use the term the competition roles within the business. Everybody was fine with, you know, making the product and shipping the product and getting it where needed, but anything that was competition, we didn't like competition. Our business, our people didn't like it. And I had to sort of step up to that level to be the father figure of the organization. And it was a long, hard, cold place to be on my own. But lucky to somebody who gave me a dose of reality that said, and I come to myself and said, no, I can do much better than this. This is my personal how I done it. So to answer the question in two words was, I pushed myself unknowingly to lead.
Mm-hmm. You were pulled out of being in the operations, into a new role. Right. But you did it. You obviously let it happen then once you let somebody come in behind you as well, which was very
well. As soon as I wasn't too long in the role and it was, you know, I moved out and so somebody had said, oh, he's the MD. You know, all of a sudden, I may have been the owner of the business and I may have been working as one of the guys, but all of a sudden I get this title as MD. And very, very quickly I said, well, you know, a managing director, and I googled what an MD was and said it was a managing director, and then I started to read what it actually a managing director's roles and responsibilities and titles and all this stuff, and I said, well, I'm not doing any of that. I said, well, I better start doing some of that. So then I started to delegate some of the roles that I had too. So I got somebody who was very good with finance, I got them in, so they dealt with the bank, they dealt with this. So very, very quickly I took the textbook and I sort of said, well, if this is what I'm supposed to do, I'm doing. And I love it then, you know, this pointing the finger and saying, get this done and get that done and all the rest, and being the proper MD, I thought was wonderful. And that allowed me, it gave me the time to question. And I think it was one of the biggest successes of MJM's career. It generally would have been one of the biggest successes was the fact that I understood the business from going to buy a sheet of plywood, cutting it with a handsaw, making a product with it or a piece of timber and selling that. And I knew everything from driving the van to the shop to taking them, delivering the product. So there wasn't too much in the business I didn't know. So knowing that is a second nature, and then learning the other part of the business, which I rather enjoyed, because now all of a sudden I could point my finger and say, get that done, get that done, get that done. So I was the perfect MD. Managing director, because I could manage and direct people around and bully and push people and boss people about all day long. Lovely. Yeah. What that did was give me a little bit of time then to sit down and think. And then I'd go down and I'd look at the guys doing the job and I'd say, so why are you doing that? And very, very, in a very early age then we realized that, well, sure, we always done it this way. So why do you ask me that question? So you done it that way. So what do we do? But is there not a better way to do this? And then this come in, and then they see me coming, and they're throwing the head in the air and said, he's going to tell us we're doing this all wrong, and he'd not know how to fix it himself, but he's going to push us to do something different. And what's wrong with the way we're doing it? So that come to be a model, and it come to be a part of our fabric was, is there a better way to do this? And that was one of the big things. And I think that was one of the things that our customers seen about us, that we were constantly challenging ourselves when we possibly didn't actually need to challenge ourselves. We would challenge ourselves and we just got better at doing what we were doing on a constant basis. Sorry for rattling on there.
Yeah, no, that's so it was coming from within yourselves. And that was another question I was going to ask you about, that continuous learning culture that, I mean, it's even, you can see it coming true in yourself that you have that attitude or mindset to keep learning and to keep, and you've inculcated that in the business too.
As the old saying goes, I'm going to learn that all my life, you know, every day is a school day. You know, and it's very, very true, you know, and as people have said, if you're not learning, you're dead, you know, and as Michelangelo said, every day is a learning day. And I have that little logos around my office. I've stumbled across it a number of years ago and it's been there for a long time. And it's been our motto, you know, we must keep improving. We must keep learning. if we're learning about each other, we're learning about our products, we're learning about our customers, we're learning about the state of the industry. We just naturally, like, you know, it makes me very happy. You know, I go to a meeting sometime and I could be standing in a meeting and I could have four or five of my senior managers there. I've slightly stepped back, so it gives me that a little bit better of advantage. You'd be standing at the back of the room and the guys would see you smiling, and then I had to learn not to smile. But I was smiling with praise and admiration for my team. And you know, I was smiling with the fact that I'm gonna ask these guys the question, where the hell did you learn all this stuff, guys? You know, and then the guys would have a little chuckle to themselves and say, well, you know, this is this bloody incidental learning you keep talking about. Yeah. You know, so all these guys, this team of ours have just learned all this stuff, and I think it's wonderful. So yes, learning and continuous learning.
Incidental learning, you mentioned that. Can I double click on that? What do you mean by that?
Well, the last 12 or 18 months has been a very, very typical scenario of an on incidental learning, because everybody is sort of retracted by law or by governments, or by the pandemic. We have contracted back into our homes and back into our lives, and our forward facing side is on what we're doing now. Is on a Teams or a Zoom or some other social media outlet. And you know, you come on with a purpose, you come on with an objective, you want to hear something, you want to find something, you want to say something, and you come and you go and you leave, and you've just learned, or you found out something that you needed to, that you set out to do, and you went home. Now, if I had to say to you, well, I'll, you're flying in from somewhere, so I'll meet you in whatever, Dublin or London or New York or whatever, and sure, listen, sure, we're here, we'll have a cup of tea and we'll have even a bottle of beer or whatever the case is, and we start having a general conversation about life or business or what we were there to discuss. The incidental learning that you're going to learn that evening, or I'm going to learn that evening, I'm going to learn things from you that I never knew before, and you're going to learn things from me. So that's incidental learning that all goes into our brain, and you know, we regurgitate it and it goes in there and it's locked in, and then sometime we're very bright people because, oh yeah, I remember, we can do A, B, C, D, and away and away.
I heard this somewhere else, or yeah, absolutely. I picked up some learning.
And that's, we've got all our staff back into the office now, and the biggest thing with that is we've been pushing very hard for that. It was the incidental learning over how all the staff mingle, how they get on together, all the, of course, with social distancing and all the different new tools that we've used to make sure everybody's safer and so on and so forth. And, but still with all of that social distancing, even with eye contacts and voices and so on and so forth, there's still more incidental learning than there was when everybody's stuck at home in their own.
At home. Very good. Very good. So you can see a real value in all of that, in people getting back together in as soon as they can in office settings or work settings. Yeah.
Yeah, it may be different. Whatever the new norm is, we're going to find it.
Yeah,
but most certainly we will, in all of that, whatever that is, there'll be, again, we will go back to the term of incidental learning.
Right, very good, very good. That's great insight. And just on your talk about learning, I mean, learning over during a crisis, we had it whatever 12 years ago, we're coming through one now. What have you learned?
I'm just smiling and saying about 12 years ago. I'm really going to show my age now. You're just showing your age. You're only a cub. I'm showing my age. I'm going back to the, you know, when we had the first recession in the late 80s. You know, I very specifically remember one then. And then I remember one in the 90s. And then we all remember the 2007 to our 2008 or 9 or 10 recession. Yeah. We all remember that one. And I don't think any of us is going to forget this current one that we're in at the moment. So, you know, I think we're quite naive this time around. I think the question is, what have we learned from all the recessions to help us through this one? Is that what we're really saying?
Yeah, well, it's yeah, to see what you've done over the past year or so, that as a result of your experience over the years, that has helped you through it.
During the very first recession, I pulled a rug over my head and said, you know, just keep our heads down and keep on going and it'll pass. And it didn't really. It severely hurt me. It nearly put me out of business. But the business was so small again, so the business went down to probably one-tenth the size that it was, which wasn't very big anyway, but went drastically descaled. And as I built back up the business over the next 5 or 6 years, I always said, wow, the lessons learned out of there. Now, what would I do different? I'm talking to myself all the time. What would I do different if I was doing this, if this ever happened again? And then it did happen. So I put the lessons learned for the first time into action the second time, and was quite good. Was good. Could have been much better. Mm-hmm. And then we had the one in 2009, and I learned from what I learned of the first two. One thing that I learned with the third one that I went through, which was the 2008 and 9 one, was I knew what I had to do. My managers knew what we had to do, but none of us done it.
Mm. Too hard.
We sat on it. Mm. We talked about it. Mm. You know, it was like a tin can in the office. You know, we kept kicking the tin can at each other.
Yeah.
And, you know, we'd get exhausted thinking about the consequences of having to do what we had to do. And we hadn't got a pile of money in the bank. We had some, we weren't too bad. We had some money, but...
And you were expanding at the time as well, isn't it? We were building new space.
We just moved into a new factory. It cost us 5.5 million. Mm. And we just got the debt in the bank for it. And we only had moved in about a month before the sort of the big crash comes. So, well, we kicked the can in front of us. We had some money down the road in the banks to get through it. And we probably were about 6 or 7 months slow at making a decision. And that decision, about 3 years later, almost busted the company. Mm. That was the big, at the time it was sore. It really was sore to do what we had to do. We cut our staff in half. A lot of people locally would have known. We just cut our staff in half in 2009 or something. We should have done it about August time in the year before. We said we wouldn't do it, and then we're close to Christmas. We couldn't do it at Christmas, and then we couldn't do it till after January. And then in January then, didn't really matter. We were still the big bad wolf. Well, maybe we'd done it. Mm-hmm. We'd used up a lot of cash we had in reserves, mm-hmm. which 2 years down the line, we really, really needed the cash. We hadn't got the cash.
Yeah.
So the lessons learned is, if you have a decision to make, you know, be kind about it, be straight about it, but make the bloody decision and get on with it.
Yeah.
Stop hanging around and hiding under the bush and kicking the can up and down the road. It doesn't make life any. It has to happen. If you've got a problem, then as the more mature you get and the bigger your business gets, then you realize that you've got responsibilities. You've got responsibilities to all the external stakeholders within your business. If you've got a board of directors or shareholders or whatever the case, you've got responsibilities, equal responsibilities to all those people as you have to your staff. Mm-hmm. You know, there's no one takes priority over the other, or no one should. They all should be treated the same. So in this recession, I acted really quick. Unfortunately, the news, what has happened to the cruise industry, actually, and I still think about it, it actually shocks me to how quick it actually come to us. And it really shocked me how quick. We were having lunch on a Thursday at dinner time, on the 12th of March, Thursday, 12th of March. Next day was Friday the 13th, you never forget it. That evening, we got 3 or 4 phone calls. By the Monday morning, every contract that we were working on and every contract we had in the books, about £100 million worth of work cancelled within a 3-day period. Globally, within the whole business, 2,000 people actively working on all different projects. We were working in 5 different continents, 20 different countries, blah, 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 all around the world. Mm. And we were receiving emails by the minute to say that we will not honor any bills after a certain time today or whatever the case is. So yeah. We went into total free fall where everybody was organizing to get the people home safely. Was the first big thing was to get everybody home in their houses safely. By the following Wednesday, within 7 days from the first email coming in, everybody was back in their home.
Wow.
I think there was something like 1,300 people all over the globe that had to get flights, and they were getting flights, and flights were being cancelled, and some people were getting, instead of getting one flight to get home, where we had to book them 6 or 7 flights and put them into 3 or 4 hotels. It was my team of people, you know, I give them full admiration. And you know, a lot of the people realized that this was the beginning of the end.
Mm.
You know, and most a lot of my smart, we employ a lot of very, very smart, intelligent people, and could say, well, you know, our markets is coming to an end. What's likely to happen to us? There's going to be huge, huge payoffs. But everybody kept focused, got everybody home into their houses, got everybody safe. And this time I didn't kick the can down the road.
Mm.
I just went in and said, I asked my senior management team to go and have a conversation on their own, to go home, to spend a couple of hours discussing the options, go home, come back in the next morning and tell me what the plan was. And we done that, and unfortunately it resulted in huge, huge numbers of them and people losing their roles and their jobs and so on and so forth. But on a positive note, we're back reemploying and going again. So the message out of that is, if you have a decision to make, good, bad or indifferent, just get it made.
Got to make it, yeah. And in that vein, I mean, following on from that, you are now back, your feet under the table, growing, looking forward to a lot of people again.
We're probably in the last 3 weeks, we're probably taking on about two people a week. I would say within the next month we'll probably go, I would imagine we'll double or treble our employment numbers in the next 12 months. I think we'll probably be ending up that we'll have a couple of hundred, we'll be employing at least a couple of hundred people in the next year.
Yeah, right, very good.
We're on the build back.
Right.
Now, this is a bold move to make this statement, but you know, I don't have a lot of facts. I don't have a lot of my customers ringing me and telling me this information. Well, I'm going to make a prediction, and I do believe that MJM will be back to where they were within the next 2 years.
Fantastic.
So back employing a couple of thousand people again. The group.
So, yeah. And key to all of this, right throughout, you've stayed in Uri. You've very much made it the center of your operations. Going all around the globe, as you just described, how important is that to you, and how important what importance do you put on actually our ability here in the island of Ireland to compete on a world stage and have ventures like yours in different parts of the country?
You know, the world keeps changing all the time. You know, and whenever I set my business up almost 40 years ago, it was Ireland and Northern Ireland, and the world was a very different place than it was 30 years ago than it was 20 years ago than it was 10 years ago and than it was last year. So it has been a moving feat. So I can't sit with any authority and tell any budding entrepreneur what to do, how to do, or why to do it, or when to do it. But what I can, all I can do is tell you some of the things that happened to me. I was very comfortable. I was very, very comfortable. I worked very, very hard. And whenever I came home in the evening, it was very comfortable. And when my mother and my father and my brothers and my sisters and all were there, and so, and then all of a sudden, then I met my wife, and then I was my wife and our own new house, and then our kids and so on and so forth. That all started to come through. I was very, very comfortable. As long as I was with them and they were with me, I could have been anywhere in the world.
Mm.
But you know, I love Ireland. I generally have to say I really, really, really love Ireland. And I'm very lucky that had created a business or was allowed to create a business or was helped to create a business that took me to nearly every art and part of the world. You know, I've been in Tasmania, New Zealand, Australia, every Caribbean island has been all over America, Canada, Australia, you name it, we've been there. A fair bit in the Far East and the Middle East as well. All of the time I get in an airplane and I'm going out for business, my people are going out for the business, every one of us want to get home again.
Mm.
Doesn't matter if we're going out for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or 6 weeks. You know, at the end of the thing, the big prize for us is getting back home again. So for whatever type of people we are, we love the island. It's home. Our families, our friends, and our communities are here. And I've had the opportunity. I've had non-executive directors. I had all sorts of people telling me that there's a better cost base somewhere else around the world. We should be moving here, we should be moving there.
Mm.
But you know, I think we were lucky to find a business, a very, very strong business that had a very strong family connection and was built around families. You know, the cruise industry is built around happy times, happy times as family times. Family times as the family all together. We were very, very lucky that our customers have come to see us. We're very, very focused, as you can see, with the cruise ships and building the families and building happy experiences for families. So hence, we decided to stay, and because I love the island and I love the people on the island, I'd be very much an Irish person at heart. I love my home. So I've kept my business there. I could have had it anywhere in the world. It probably would have made commercial sense. If I had been a smart accountant, I probably would have went something else, but it was a dumb joiner, so I kept it at home.
far from dumb. Well, there's a question here, Brian, from Michael Burke. Just asking, Brian, what part of your journey with MGM have you gained the greatest joy and satisfaction from? What would you regard as the most difficult aspect and challenge of your leadership so far?
My most difficult memories within the business was shortly after 2011. Hence from the earlier conversation around kicking the can around and how we got ourselves into a situation that was untenable. We were in a dark period for a while, but with good relationships with customers and good relationships with bankers and good relationships with suppliers and employees and so on and so forth, we worked our way out of it. A very, very dark time. Don't want to be back there again. I've explained to some of the things that I've learned from that and what I would do different. Yeah. Another one that was, I was 7 years going to America to trade shows, a very, very costly thing in the younger years, going to trade shows. 7 years before I got my first contract.
Wow.
It wasn't as if that I went out to America and they're all standing there and said, come on in, McConnell, we have a load of work for you. It took 7 years. It took me building relationships, took me spending a lot of money to get relationships. And the big thing that they kept throwing back is, me, you work on ferries, we're cruise ship owners. Cruise ships is the next level. We find a little bit of that conversation then when we went to break into the mega yacht. Oh yeah, anybody can work on a cruise ship, but working on a mega yacht, very, very different.
Yeah.
So we had to work through those different markets. Difficult times, got through them. So those are some of the downsides of my life from the mega yacht.
And the greatest joy of all?
Is, you know, really and truly, I have a son and a daughter. Well, I have two daughters in the business. I have one son. I have three children out of four, very, very active in the business. And to see the professionalism of them, see how my senior management team of the MGM learned a huge amount of me over the years, and I learned a huge amount of them and other people, and we took it all together and we learned the best of them all. And to see how they take my children along and help my children, I am great. You know, it fills me with joy.
Great.
I have a business that I believe. I have a team of people headed by some very strong senior managers and my family that can lead my business into the future.
Into the future. That leads to David Beatty's popped in a question here on this kind of topic, when he's saying, you know, being an owner and leader of a fairly substantial private business, what your thoughts are on succession planning regarding the ownership and management. Is that something work in progress, or have you strong views on it?
I have pretty strong views on it. I started that journey, David, about 4 years ago. Some of the things that I learned about my what was a managing director's role and so on and so forth was to manage and direct. And whenever I had the vision that this is how I was going to structure the business for the future, I brought in a person to do that. That didn't work out so successfully, so then we had to go back to the drawing board and work at it again. And on our second or third attempt, we found the right person that understood exactly what the process was. They built a small team around them and they delivered it. And we have a very, very supple, agile business that is fit for purpose. And it's taken a long time, cost a lot of money. And I'm happy to say I'm penniless. So it's all, everything's into trusts and into structures and into group companies and everything. Because any guys that's out there, any people out there that have set up their own business will all have known that, you know, they had one golden goose that laid the egg. So everything they've done in life, from the buying the groceries to buying the new car to doing whatever to investing in another business or getting involved, there was always one pot of money that was strained all the time, which was the main topic of the business. Well, yeah. You can imagine the size that MJM, our turnover in 2019 was in the group, was just slightly less than 200 million sterling, 187 million sterling.
Yeah.
Strong business. We had branched out into about 15 different companies, three of them which I mentioned, lots of other little small subsidiaries and so on and so forth.
Mm.
And there was an absolute minefield of this company had loaned that company money and that company, and it was just a total minefield. And we had to sit down and straighten it all up and get the right structures. And it took us 3 years.
Right.
A lot of money, a lot of hard work. We had to change direction a couple of times, but we got there. And biggest part of that was, a lot of that was moving assets and moving stuff from doing all of that. But you know, playing the game myself was one of the hardest things. You know, I was fine to direct my finger to tell other people to do other things.
Yeah.
But to settle down and to say, you know, you're the one that asked for this. This is the one that created it. Why are you going to break your own rules?
Mm.
You know, the rules are there to be played by. So don't be, you know, have the board meeting, get the non-executive directors, tell them what you want to do, ask the permission to do it, and don't run off and be in the maverick.
Yeah.
I think those are some of the things that I'm really, really having to concentrate on learning now. Mm.
Great insight to have come to at this stage as well, and an important stage too.
Yes.
Well, look, Brian, we've had a fantastic time. Thank you very much for your insights. Just to finish on one question, I know you were on the Queen's Honours list and awarded this year. That must have been a great, you must have been very pleased with that, a great acknowledgement of your life's work so far. But what does it mean for you?
You know, I think it's success. One of the things whenever somebody says, what does it mean? And it says, it means that I think I must have been successful. Somebody has thought enough of me to write a letter to somebody, to whatever, and for somebody to take time and read an A4 or whatever they read and say, you know what, this guy is genuinely a good guy and he deserves an honour. So I have to say I was thrilled, I was honored whenever I got the first phone call and they said, you know, you can't tell anybody. And I said, you know, don't tell me anything, you don't want any of it, because I just tell everybody everything, you know, that's just how I rock and roll. But they said, no, you can't tell anybody anything. And I said, well, not even my family. And he says, no, just nobody. So I was delighted, I was honored.
Yeah.
I think, you know, people ask me all the time, what's success? And I keep looking for success. So I keep saying to people, whenever I find success, I'll tell you what success looks like. But I think with winning, by getting the Queen's Award or so on and so forth, and I look at the lists and I do different things, I think there's a certain amount of success is tied into that honour as well. So, yeah, those are the things I think.
Very good. Very good. Well, look, thank you for being so candid and generous and sharing this afternoon, your insights and experience. It's really inspirational, and I think your integrity and ambition and the relationships you've built as well, they're really values that we strongly identify with as well in Timoney. And so thank you very much.
We're only halfway through the journey.
Whoa. That's right. We'll have you back for another for the other half.
Hopefully the business is only halfway through its overall journey. I hope all the best and all the excitement. The excitement is yet to come with the next generation of leaders and so on and so forth. So thank you very much for having me on.
No.
I hope I didn't bore too many of your listeners, but
far from it.
That's how it goes.
Excellent.
So is that us finished up then, Ronan?
Well, just before closing, I'm just going to let people know a little bit about what's coming up next. Tuesday, we're going to be joined by Professor Anneloos Rays of the SA Business School for our May masterclass, which is on the whole area of this topic. In fact, we've been talking to Brian about building a great team. So Anneloos will be joining us on team performance and getting those results that that we all want to see. That's on Tuesday. Then we're also delighted to announce that we've launched our autumn edition of the Advanced Leadership Program, coming out of the pandemic. We're going to be back with our Advanced Leadership Program. So that is going to kick off in September. And I suppose just to ask you to maybe, for those of you who haven't been on the Advanced Leadership Program, do give it a look. And for those of you who have as well, to think of colleagues, friends, acquaintances who you think might benefit from, as we emerge out of this pandemic, from being on a program like this, to, you know, rebuilding your company culture, rebooting your leadership, embracing with confidence the challenges and the opportunities that are coming for businesses in the years ahead. And then finally, to say this particular chat with Brian will be on our podcast channel in the next day or so, and there's other previous webinars and podcasts there, so be sure to dip into that on whatever channel you use and subscribe to it. And thank you again for tuning in to listen, and thank you, Brian, for your generosity in sharing the insights, and to Claire and Alison and Katrina as well for helping with putting the session on today. Look forward to seeing you back again soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.